without his name. Victory forever is a song of the redeemed. I know my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior, every day brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior, yeah, go.
Hey!
shout it out. Day is a day. We worship and adore you. Day is a day. We lift our hands up to exalt you. We long to see your glory in this place.
Everybody, this is your first time. Welcome. This is your 100th time. Excellent. Turn to somebody, give them a holy high five or a holy fist bump. If you know them, blow it up. You know what I'm saying? If you know them, blow it up. Don't be blowing it up unless you know them. Thank you.
open our hearts today that we could receive from you, because there's nothing like you, you know. And Father, we look at the creation and we see the beauty and all that you've created. We look at the wonders of this world and they all pale in comparison to your greatness and your grandeur. And we acknowledge today that we're just really finite beings and we can't even with these little minds comprehend your greatness. But we say today we love you, we want you more than anything else, and we ask that you would connect with us today in this service in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen. Why don't you guys take a seat just for a second? Yeah, you can give it up for the band here. They did a pretty decent job, you know. Yeah, so in case you're new today, my name is Doug. I'm one of the pastors here. And in case you're like not a Christian and you're coming to kind of observe some Christians in their natural habitat, and you're observing the worship and the music and all that, people are raising their hands. Well, if you're new to church, that when people raise their hands up, that's kind of like, you know, lifting your lighter at a concert. You know what I mean? That's kind of what it's like. In fact, from time to time, a few of our people even light their lighters or whatever, and that's okay here. So I just wanted to explain that. And if you're new, you'll also find us to be a fairly diverse tribe up here. We like to say we've got everyone here from bikers to bankers, PhDs to GEDs, and some who are white collar, some who are blue collar, and I've even seen people walk in with dog collars on. So all different types of us here that are part of the tribe here, and we kind of like it like that, right? Yeah. So there are a few announcements I need to make you guys aware of before we continue with the service. One is that on July the 8th, you can see that we're going to have some baptisms take place. We'll roll the trough out here. We'll dunk some people. And if one of your relatives is getting baptized and you slip me a five, I'll hold them under just a little bit longer, you know, to make sure that they get totally cleansed by the Lord. And if you're afraid of water and you're going to be baptized, I'm just kidding, okay? So John's going to be talking a bit about the Going Deeper retreat coming up on August the 19th. We've been talking about that for the past couple of weeks, so you can sign up for that in the lobby on your way out if you would like. And then the last thing I need to make you guys aware of is the offering. If you're new here, the way that we fund the ministry is through our tithes, or tithe is just a Bible word that means tenth, and through our offerings. And we have a what we call a joy box in the back. Some people like to give their offerings there. You have an envelope in your program, and so you pull those programs out and those envelopes. Show me those. Make sure we got those. Can you do that for me? Maybe. Okay, thank you. I see a few of those, and some of you are not like participating along with me on that, and so be careful. You never know what that could cause, but that envelope there, you can fill that out if you'd like to give, and drop that in the offering box, or you'll see if a giving kiosk in the lobby. If you would like to give electronically, you can also give at citychurchdowntown.com. You just click on the giving link. And I want to thank you guys for your generosity, because just this past week, the basketball team at Fox Tech got to go on their first Christian basketball camp because of your generosity this past week. So, and I wish all of you could have seen Coach Kellen's face. Coach Kellen is a guy that goes to church here, and he's the head basketball coach at Fox Tech. When we told him that our church is going to fund basketball camp for all the players, and he was just delighted and so happy, because, you know, every day he's working with the guys over there. Some of those guys never even been out of San Antonio, and they got to go you know, to this camp out of state and have such an amazing time. So thank you again for your generosity, and we want to continue that generosity so that we can continue to be catalysts for spiritual and social change right here in San Antonio and around the world. Well, I understand that it's the day for fathers. Is that right, fathers? Okay. So, fathers, I are one of you, and so I understand the way you feel about your special day, and so I'm not going to embarrass you a lot, fathers, but I do want you to stand up, if you would, okay? So, would all the fathers just stand up? Now, before you clap for them, just a minute, all the rest of you are about to take the Father's Day pledge, okay? Because since I am a father, I understand what fathers want today. Fathers do not want drama. Fathers want food today. They don't want to have to do anything today, is what we, you know, so don't plan a bunch of stuff for us today, anybody else, but we just want to sit around, okay? And we want food, and we want other things that Pastor Doug's not going to talk about today in church, okay? So you should say that. So So I'm going to create a special little pledge, and so I want you to raise your right hand, all the rest of you. Fathers, you can keep your hands down because you're receiving here, right? Okay, raise your right hand, and here's what you say to the dads today. I will pamper you. I will honor you. I will be at your beck and call to be your slave in all things before God and my pastor. Thank you, Dad. Sit down. Let's give it up for our dads today. That's good. That's good. So, I'll quit goofing off here in a minute. We'll get to a real sermon or something like that. But let's kind of transition in our hearts and minds now. And by the way, I was serious about all that, so you better do all that for our dads. And they're going to report back to me next week how you served and honored them. But let's kind of transition our hearts now to a place of saying, hey, God, I'm open to you. God, I'm open as John comes to present the word here in just a minute. Let's open our hearts and say, God, I want to receive from you. If you're new to church and you're just saying, God, if you're really out there, would you somehow connect with me? And you know, the past couple of weeks, as we've honestly prayed that, those of you that are spiritual explorers, people are actually getting connections with God. Sometimes it's funny how you ask God, would you reveal yourself if you're really out there? And he does. It's an amazing place. So, God, now that's really our prayer, is that you would connect with us. Explorers, connect with us who are your followers. In Jesus' name, amen.
I was baptized into the Anglican faith when I was in Scotland about 12 years old and didn't get any support from that church when I got back home. When I moved back to America, ensuing 30-something years, I spent a long time building a fortress of reason around my life, exploring spirituality, but not really religion, and certainly not Christianity. When I first started to come to BRCC, I felt that fortress of reason get demolished brick by brick. That's why I cry in church. And those were tears of pain, because everything that I had built my life on was being destroyed by God and put back together in a different way. And for most of the fall of last year, I thought that I could live with an existential God, a God that I believed in because I made him exist and his rules worked. And so I didn't need a supernatural God. And then I met Luke. And Luke is a scientist, a physician, he's a historian, he's a writer. I'm a scientist, I'm a historian, I'm a writer. Luke walked with people who walked with Jesus. He took one-on-one interviews, face-to-face interviews with the mother of Jesus Christ, and he walked with Paul. And he wrote down what he saw. And when I met Luke, I could no longer deny a supernatural God. I could no longer deny a redeeming, saving God.
Over the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at the whole issue of transitioning spiritually, and part of what John is sharing with us there this morning is just how a transition took place in his life. And just for those of you who haven't been around the last few weeks, just a quick review. What we've essentially said about that is that the way that we transition in our lives spiritually is by doing two things. We have two questions related to those. One is, have you told your story? And the other is, do you know God's story? If we are gonna grow as Christians, however you wanna say that, if we're gonna become spiritually formed, if God is going to do some kind of a deep work in our lives and change us, one of the things that we have to do is we have to tell our stories. And just for the sake of review, what we've said over the last couple of weeks is that when we tell our life stories, there are several things that happen to us. One thing that happens to you and me is we see patterns of our worst ways. And we also come to see the people that we have harmed in those patterns whenever we're walking in our worst ways. And when we tell our stories and we see that, and we make amends for the relational fallout that happens in our lives, God heals our relationships. We've also talked about the fact briefly that God begins to show to us when we tell our stories the core issues that lie really deep in our hearts and minds. Things like unhealed wounds, unmet needs, fear, or pride that we have. And as the Spirit of God begins to reveal those to us, one of the things that happens to us when we tell our stories is God begins to heal us. But another thing that he does, besides healing us, is he also helps others. And in fact, we talk a lot around here about being catalyst for spiritual and social change. And one of the primary ways that God uses you as a catalyst to change other people's lives and to help them is he uses your story. Because believe it or not, God has something that he wants to say to the world through you and through your life story. And so telling our stories, we really believe, not only heals us, but it helps others. And as awesome as that is, what I want to say to you today is that that's not enough. There's something else that we actually have to do with story besides telling our story. And John de la Hunt discovered that. He discovered that whenever he went to the Word of God and for himself began to read what God had said to him out of the Gospel of Luke. That was his story. That's how he began to see his life story and how his life connected with God's story. And that's really what I want to say to you today, is that in order for us to find meaning in our lives, to really see the value of our own life story, somehow we have to connect our story to God's. And today, I wore my worst pair of jeans to help me be able to do that, okay? They also happen probably to be the most expensive ones. I don't buy this brand, but my future son-in-law gave them to me. So I think they're pretty expensive. Anyway, what I want to show you here is this strand of string. Now, you know, most of you probably got some of this somewhere on your body right now, but this strand of string is kind of like our stories, your story and mine. It's just one strand of string. Can you see it? A little bit, right? It's one strand of string. But whenever you and I, if we just sort of live in our own little world, if I just sort of live my one strand of string life, it's really not all that significant. I know it seems significant to us at the time, but in the grander scheme of things, this one little strand of string doesn't mean that much. But whenever I find my life story, whenever I see how my life connects to God's larger story, what God does is he weaves all of our stories together in with the larger, grander story that he is telling. And in the process of doing that, God makes something remarkable. Not just a strand of string from my jeans, but a whole set of jeans, if you will. Something that we can actually use, something that makes us a part of what God is doing in this world. And so, to find meaning in our lives, we have to see how our lives, how our strand of string, got another one here, I know you can see that one, how our strand of string actually fits and gets woven into God's greater story. Recently, I heard a story that I would call a strand of string story, all alone, apart from God. And the story went like this. One of our pastors last summer was at church when a woman that he knew came running up to him and began literally pounding him on the chest. And she cried out as she did that. She said, "God killed my sister." Well, needless to say, he was shocked and So he said to her, you know, tell me what happened. And she began to pour out this horrible news that she herself had just received about her sister and her family who lived in Mexico. Turns out the story went like this. You're well aware that over the last years, there's been a huge drug war raging in Mexico, and some of the cartel members in the area where her family lived had been arrested, apprehended, they had been indicted, and they had been tried on narcotics charges. Not only did the lawyer who defended them not gain an acquittal for them, those cartel members also received the harshest sentence available under the law. And so, as you may have heard before, furious at this kind of an outcome, the cartel put a hit out on that lawyer. Well, what happened after that is simply one of the worst stories that you can possibly imagine, because in the process of carrying out that hit, this woman's brother-in-law, who is also a lawyer, was misidentified by the assassins. They went to the wrong address and proceeded to murder him, his wife, who was her sister, and their two children, one of whom was only 4 years old. Their entire family was executed for something they knew nothing about, had no relationship to, and were completely innocent of. She had just received this news. And so, understandably, she ran at this pastor and screamed out, "Why did God kill my sister?" Well, the pastor tried to console her, and he began saying, "You know, I'm so sorry." But she kind of snarled at him and said, "Stop telling me you're sorry and tell me why." And then she proceeded to offer her own explanation. She said, "I know why. God's a monster." Well, over the next few months, this pastor continued to try to reach out to her, and he made multiple phone calls, but most of the time she wouldn't answer. Twice when she did answer, she literally cussed him out. And finally, she told him, "I want nothing to do with you, with your church, or with your God." And to this day, she feels this way toward everything and anyone associated with God. This story is so wrong that alone, it seems like a worthless strand of string. It has left this woman cynical and bitter. It has left her skeptical and snarling. And it forces, I think, us to ask the question, can we possibly find meaning in the monstrous moments of our lives? Is it really possible for us to live lives that turn out good whenever so much in our lives are bad? And today, I want to suggest to us that our lives, apart from God, are simply a single strand of string. That we find no meaning in our lives apart from God. Now, if anyone ever had a right to kind of snarl at God because of his story, it would be the biblical character Joseph in the Old Testament. We can read about his story in Genesis 37 to 50, and I want to just summarize a few things for you today from his life story. In fact, kind of three things that happened to Joseph that could have left him cynical and snarling at God and everyone associated with him. You may even identify with some of these in your own story. One thing that happened to Joseph is he grew up in an incredibly dysfunctional family. His father was a schemer who ended up marrying four different women. And I had a friend in Africa who always used to say, "One wife, one problem." And so we kind of, you know, picked up on that. So Jacob had four, right? All right, well, turned out that Joseph was his father's favorite because he was the firstborn son of Jacob's favorite wife, Rachel. And that might sound like a pretty good thing, but Jacob also had 11 other sons. And with Joseph being the favored of his father, what ended up happening to him is that the other brothers began to hate him. In fact, they hated him so much, we are told, that they even wanted to kill him. And when they finally had the chance to do it, thanks to one of his brothers who kind of saved him from it, instead of killing him, all they did was sell him into slavery into the nation Egypt. I mean, can you imagine that kind of life? This is like a Cinderella story on steroids. Remember how her stepmom hated her so much? This was Joseph's experience. At the tender age of 17, his brothers, instead of killing him, sold him into slavery. And you know, I think about just the number of stories that I have heard as a pastor and how many of you might connect with that and might say, you know, my story of origin, my family of origin, my nuclear family is such a bad story that I don't see how anything good can ever come of that. You can either end up being kind of cynical about where you came from, or I want to suggest that if you'll tell your story, if you'll really look at it, God can redeem that. He can heal you of that, and that he can use it to actually help other people who have a story similar to your own. Well, Joseph not only came from a dysfunctional family, but he suffered for doing what was right. This was the second thing that it could have caused him to end up being kind of cynical and snarling at God. Whenever he got sold into Egypt, when he finally got there, a rich guy by the name of Potiphar bought him. And things actually started looking up for Joseph at that point, because Joseph had these incredible administrative skills. He just knew how to make things work. And he was so good at it that Potiphar literally turned his whole household over to him. Joseph had just one problem. He was a good-looking kid, apparently, because Potiphar's wife got attracted to him and began noticing him. And so she just kept coming on to him over and over again. Come to bed with me, sleep with me. And again, you know, for some that might like, wow, what a lucky guy. But he didn't see it that way. Joseph had learned that if he did that, it would be a sin against her. It'd be a sin against his boss. It'd be a sin against God himself. And so he continually refused and rebuffed her appeals to him. Well, eventually she herself began to feel kind of rejected as a result of that. And so one day she falsely accused him and had him literally thrown into jail. Now, you know, most of us, we understand that if I suffer for something that I do wrong and I have to pay for that, okay, we get that. But the idea of having to suffer when I've done right seems all wrong. It seems completely unfair. In fact, I remember just one of the kind of saddest stories, a small one, is our neighbors in Africa. We had missionary neighbors who lived next door to us, and there was a woman who worked for them. She was like gold. I mean, just sweet, a great personality, a great disposition, hard worker. And over time, over a couple of years, her health began to deteriorate, and turns out that she was actually the first African person I knew who died of HIV/AIDS. When the story came out, turns out that she was not the culprit in this matter at all, but that her husband had cheated on her and had infected her with the disease, and she died because of his unfaithfulness. That's not what we expect in life. That's not how we expect it to turn out. Imagine how that would make you feel. And that's what happened to Joseph. Life wasn't fair to him. Well, he was put into prison, but again, his administrative skills were obvious to the warden, and so the warden put him in charge of all the other prisoners there. And at the age of 28 now, it looked like Joseph might actually have an opportunity to get out of jail, and maybe his life would begin to work out for him. There were a couple of really important prisoners who had come into the prison who had worked for the king, and he had helped them out. And he told them as they got out of prison, hey, don't forget me. But the third strike against Joseph that could have left him cynical and kind of snarling at God is that when they got out, they forgot completely about Joseph. And so people that he had helped didn't even remember him, didn't even seem to care. And he languished there in prison for 2 more years. Now, try to let this picture sort of soak into your mind. He's been hated his whole life by his brothers. At age 17, they sold him into slavery instead of killing him. He's falsely accused, thrown into prison, and now at 28 years old, he is at very rock bottom. He's in the dungeon of his life. He's totally abandoned. He's rotting away for a crime that he did not commit. Imagine this as the lowest moment of his life. If ever a person had a right to become cynical and to snarl at his story and at God, it was Joseph. I mean, I can imagine him kind of like the Count of Monte Cristo. If I ever get out of here, I'm going to get even with everyone who ever did me wrong. But after 2 years at rock bottom, Joseph's life unexpectedly took a turn for the better. He was called to an audience with the king of Egypt. You see, the king had had some dreams, and they were so weird that nobody could interpret them, but the guys he had helped in prison remembered that Joseph was able to interpret dreams. And so they called Joseph before the king, and to make a long story short, what Joseph did is he interpreted the king's dreams, and he helped the nation Egypt avert an agricultural and ecological disaster, because Joseph was able to tell them there are going to be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of the severest kind of drought. And unless you take a fifth of all the grain that you grow during the good years, not only will our people will die, but so will all the other nations around. And, you know, in Africa, we've learned a little bit about drought here. I mean, we're sort of in a drought right now, and last year was a pretty tough drought. You remember here in Texas, not much grew. But, you know, can you imagine going to HEB and there not being anything on the shelves? That's kind of a foreign thought for us, isn't it? But, you know, when we lived in Africa, you could always tell kind of the parts of the country that were really blessed, because they had these incredible amounts of food just out everywhere. And that's what this bag of rice represents. It represents blessing, and it represents God's desire to do good. And even in the story of Joseph, Joseph was able to help the nation Egypt survive this drought because God had a desire to do good to the nation Egypt. You know, what we would do is when we would go into villages, many times we would see whole areas where there were just numerous bags like this. But this is just like a 10-pound bag. These would be 50-100-pound bags of rice and of corn and beans and maize meal and all different kinds of commodities available there. And there would be so much of them, they'd kind of pile them up. And it was an example of how blessed they were. Well, you know what? In Joseph's life, one of the things we learned from it is that God wanted to do good to the nation Egypt, and he wanted to use Joseph to do it. And so what happened in Joseph's story is that he saved up all this food, and as the drought began to come on, 2 years into it, the only nation around that had any food at all was the nation Egypt. In fact, not only that, but other surrounding nations heard that there was grain in Egypt, and so they began to come to Egypt as well, and God used Joseph to do good, to save the lives of people from other surrounding nations. Not only that, but Joseph's family heard that there was grain in Egypt. And so they also came to Egypt and were able to buy grain. And again, we see that God wanted to do good, and that he wanted to use Joseph to do it, even to save the life of his own brothers who had wanted to take his. But I want us to pause there for a moment in the story, because I want to ask the question, how could Joseph possibly do good to his brothers who had wanted to do harm to him. I mean, if you were in Joseph's position, wouldn't you want to get even with him? Because as we read the story of Joseph, we find that when his brothers finally show up to buy grain from him, Joseph is now 41 years old. Two-thirds of his life has been spent suffering because of the hatred of his brothers. And yet, whenever they came to him, the second time they came to buy grain, Joseph finally revealed to them that he was their brother. They hadn't seen him in 24 years. They thought he was dead and gone. They were absolutely dumbfounded that he was even still alive. And I want you to listen to what Joseph said to them when he finally let them know who he was. In Genesis 45, 4 to 8, this is what Joseph said. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here." It's like, what? And I'm thinking like, don't worry, I got plenty of anger stored up for all of us, right? I mean, how could he possibly say that? He said, listen to what he said, "Because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you." You see that? "God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then, it was not you who sent me, but God." Stop and think about it for a moment. Joseph is 41. Two-thirds of his life has been ruined in slavery. And now he says, "Brothers, it wasn't you who sent me here. It was God who did this." You know what this verse, you know what these verses show us? It shows us that a critical shift took place in Joseph. Somehow, Joseph came to the point in his life where he saw God's hand in his life. Joseph saw that while for 24 years of his life had kind of looked like a single strand, not worth very much. At some point in his life, he came to see that God was weaving his life story into the larger plan that God had, both for his family and for the nation. God wants to do good, and he wants to use you to do it. And the way he's going to do that is he's going to do it through your story, because God has something that he wants to say to the world through you. But for that to happen, for God to use your story, for him to redeem it, for him to heal you and to help others, you have to discover God's hand in your life. You have to see where your life, your story, fits in to his greater story. And so how does that happen? How do we find our life stories in his so that God can use us to do good? How do I come to see how God wants to weave my life story into his greater story? Well, it's really this, and this is as simple as it is, it's what I want you to see today, that to see God's hand, you have to learn God's story. To see God's hand in your life, you have to learn God's word. There is no way for us to transition spiritually apart from the word of God in our lives. I remember back when I was 77, 78, I was just finishing my first year at Baylor, and I really had no idea what I was going to do with my life. I had been through two semesters at Baylor. I already had two different majors, both of which I had started and quit in one semester, and I was actually on my way to a third major. I was going to transfer to Texas A&M to get a degree in construction engineering. I didn't know what I was doing. God saved me from being an Aggie. RG3 and all that stuff. Okay, big deal. So what? Well, I really didn't know what I was going to do with my life. And so I came home that summer to San Antonio. We were living in Boulevardi at the time, okay? And Pastor Dave and I, we had now been friends, you know, for like 7-8 years. We were good friends. And so when I would come home from school, I'd always, you know, go see him. We'd get together, whatever. And while we were together, you know, kind of telling him that, you know, didn't really know what I was going to do, going to leave Baylor, go to A&M. And Dave had really had his life together at that point. God had called him into ministry. And while he had been way more messed up than I had been up to that point in life, he was together at that moment. And you know what? Dave, I remember him saying it to me that weekend, like on a Friday. He said, "Bro, I'm telling you, God is calling you to ministry." Well, when I was 14, I had thought maybe God was doing that. And I mean, he just said it to me kind of from nowhere. Well, I spent the weekend thinking about that and praying about it, saying, is this what God wants me to do with my life? Is this the story he wants me to tell? And that weekend, God confirmed that he was calling me to ministry. And this is how he did it. He confirmed it with a voracious appetite for the Word of God. Now, let me tell you, I could eat. In those days, Poncho was a big deal. Dave and I would go to Poncho's. We raised the flag 3 times whether we were hungry or not. It was automatic, all right? We're raising it 3 times, and then we're eating, you know, sopapillas on top of that. That same kind of appetite just came out around the Word of God. So I was working on a construction crew in San Antonio. I'm 19 years old. We're working 10 hours a day, 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. on the site. I'm living in Boulevardi, having to drive in to the Alamo Heights area. It's a custom crew. It's hard work. I've never worked that hard in my life. I've done a lot of hard work, hauling hay, cutting cedar, all that. But this was a long day. I remember what happened to me that summer. I would drag in from work at the end of the day, and I quickly bathe, eat dinner that mom had for me. And my dad was a pastor. He'd be done with his study. And I'd go into the end of the house there, turn on his swing arm lamp, put it right over the scriptures, the Word of God, turn the little fan on, shut the door. And I would spend 2 to 3 hours every night, all summer long, reading the Word of God. And I'm telling you, I didn't know how to read it. I wasn't trained in it. But I'm telling you, I remember like it happened yesterday. Those words were like life to me. Well, at the end of that summer, I went back to Baylor, and there was a girl there who, she was not a Christ follower, but and didn't know what had happened to me. But not long after, you know, we had seen each other a couple times, she said, "Man, something is different about you." And something was different about me, because my life had meaning, because I had seen the hand of God in my life, and I had found my life story within God's story. And that's really the message I want to deliver to us today. That for you and me to transition spiritually, we have to do 2 things. We have to tell our story, and we have to learn God's story. So how do we do that? How do we learn the story of God? Well, let me give you just a couple of really practical ways that you can do that. First of all, I want to suggest that one of the ways we learn God's story is just through consistently having a quiet time, or a God time, as we call it around here. That's really what I did all summer long. At the end of the day, I'd go and spend a couple hours. You don't have to spend that kind of time. But consistently, there was a place and a time where I got away by myself, and there I read the Word of God. Some of you know how to do that. Some of you have no idea how to do it. I can't take the time to tell you how to do that today, except to say, let me suggest, if you've never had a God time before, let me suggest you start in the book of Proverbs. And there's a reason for that. Many of the reasons that our lives are kind of messed up, there's monstrous moments in it, there's worst ways in it, there's relational problems all over the place, is because we don't have the wisdom we need to live well. God used Solomon to write a whole book to share his wisdom with his sons, and it's called the Book of Proverbs. There's 31 chapters in it. And so what I like to encourage most people to do, if you've never had a God time, is take the date, which like today is the 17th of June. On today, the 17th, you would read the 17th chapter of Proverbs and just let God speak to you out of the wisdom of that book. And that's a great place for you to start. Consistently have a quiet time. But secondly, take advantage of opportunities this summer to learn the Word of God. Let me just point out three to you. First of all, Aaron Dockery, who's a member here, down here at the downtown campus. Aaron has a discipleship class every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. And I've listened to Aaron talk about it, and God is doing some tremendous things if you're a part of that class. He'll teach you and show you what the scriptures say, and it is life to the people who are coming to it. People will oftentimes, you know, they'll come in late to class. They'll text Aaron or call him and say, Aaron, I'm on my way, but I'm not going to miss because God's doing some really neat things around that class. Let me encourage you to take advantage of that. A second thing that we're going to make available to you this summer is a one-day Story of Grace event. This is where you learn the gospel from Genesis to Jesus in 15 stories. And we're going to do that on June the 30th. That's a Saturday coming up in not too many days. It's going to be at the home of Marcy and Cliff Sadoff. And so you can, if you want to be a part of that, we're giving downtown the first shot at these events, because next Sunday we're going to open it up to the Bandera Road campus, and you remember their hogs up there, and so they're going to take all the spots that you don't take. And so let me encourage you to consider that. A third is the Going Deeper retreat that we've been talking about these 3 weeks on August 17th to the 19th. There on that weekend in Alto Frio, you're going to be able to tell your story with a group of other people and hear their stories, and also you're going to be able to hear the story of grace. So if you can't do that on the 30th of June, you could go with us there. If you'd like to be a part of that, what you need to do is you need to call Al Guajardo at our main office at the number there. And just so you know, the deadline is this Wednesday, because next weekend I'm speaking at Bandera Road. And when we open it up there, all the spots will be gone. So you need to sign up and pay up to Al by this Wednesday. Take advantage of the opportunities that are given to you to learn the Word of God. Well, as we kind of wrap up the series, I want to ask you, are you able to believe that God really wants to do good and that He wants to use you to do it? Even with your worst ways, even with the monstrous moments, even with the relational problems, even with the core issues of wounds and needs and pride and fear, God is not ashamed of your story. He wants to use your story to say something great to the world. But in order for Him to do that, we've got to overcome some of these other issues.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, suffered as if He did. Nobody, every victory is yours. Every victory is yours. to this broken land.
The love of God for us. It was his worst way, one of his worst experiences. It could have been a monstrous one, but instead, he saw that as coming and giving his life, shedding his blood, so that we could enter into relationship with him. One of the things we believe around City Church is that the beginning to the rewriting of our stories, the beginning to the change that God wants to bring in us, starts in a relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, if you've never entered into one with him, it's not that hard. Maybe just pray a prayer, something like this, together with me. Lord, you know my story better than I know it myself. And so I bring my life before you. I thank you that through your cross you overcame. And today, to the best of my knowledge, I want to enter into a relationship with you, and I ask that you start one with me and that you change my life, change my story, weave my story into your own, and bring great meaning through my life story. Lord, I pray for us as the downtown campus of City Church, that you would overcome all the junk, all the pain, all the monstrous moments, and that you would make a great article. Use us to do good as you heal us and as you help others. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope this 3 weeks has been helpful to you. I really hope that what you'll do is that you'll tell your story. Love to have you go on retreat with us. If you don't, again this week, we just have a couple of templates in your program for you. The first one, this chart, to just help you kind of rototill your own life and get ready to tell your story. And then the second one is a graph for you to be able to graph out the low and high moments of your life over the years of your life so that you can harvest your story and tell it, because God wants to use you to change the world, and he's going to do it by the telling of your story. We appreciate you being with us so much. I want to thank you for this day, and fathers, hope you have a great day. Thank you for being here. You're dismissed. We'll see you next week.
so tired, but I can't close my eyes. I'm out of excuses, but I got plenty of lies. There's too many people, there's no one.
Long way in town.